You know, like one thing that I wanted to ask you about this film after I first saw it. And, you know, recently I also read an interview by Naritu, which was about how, you know, I don't know, maybe you had shared that and opened it, but how, you know, cinema is losing its enigmatic traits. And we're not inculcating, you know, patience in the viewer, because we're in the age of the web series now, where everything is about instant gratification and it's all episodic and, you know, dependent on like plot and narrative. And I wanted to show you a film because of how it stands apart from there. Now, there is an impenetrable, there's an impenetrable quality to it. There's an esoteric nature to it. And that's why I wanted to show that, and I love it for that. But at the same time, I wanted to ask you, in the light of that, what do you expect from a viewer to bring to the table, you know, when they come to see this film? I mean, to use a very limiting word, how important is it for you to understand the film and to be able to access it?
So, I think for me, the film was, the making of the film itself was a very different and strange experience, because we went there with totally other intentions. But slowly I would record sound in the afternoons with the ladies who you don't see in the film, because they decided that I should help them cook. So I would sit in the kitchen, and that time we would not have the camera. I would just have my sound recording device at that time. So I'd intended to make another film. And then when I came back, and Chimpi and I listened to all the sound, like hours of sound, and I realized there's another film altogether that I want to make, and which was really about the voices. So just the experience of this village, which is a Bhima Shankar, which is really like, it's quite isolated. It's in Maharashtra. And it's a proper tribal village. Like, it's quite cut off from mainstream things. Even to get there, it takes a while. And so there's also like not so much technology all the time present. There's no mobile signal. If I had to get in touch with somebody, it was really like a Kiarostami film. We would have to climb one dam to get signal, stand over there. There was no way to communicate with each other. It was like just really frustrating for anybody who makes films and you don't have your mobile connectivity. That's hard now. We're not used to it anymore. So the feeling of the space didn't allow me to make any other film because I experienced it in this way. And I think the sense of endless time and just watching the day go by is how I felt being there. And listening to certain voices that was there and waiting for the wind to move the trees was how I experienced it. And I didn't think of doing it any other way, because I think that was kind of my experience of being there.
Yeah. I mean, I feel awash with something when I see the film. And it has like a lullaby kind of like a, the tone. In fact, when we first spoke and I asked you to send me, the link to the film, and you told me that please make sure that you watch it with headphones on, because sound is a very important part of my practice. Now, and we spoke about this, that it's, I have not heard, filmmakers refer to their work, their process, their craft as a practice. But at the same time, do you feel like it's like it's a mantle then you have to sort of take on and be like beholden to it as such? Maybe you could just like talk to us about
that, the practice or sound?
I think I'll simplify the question.
What did you go there to make, and what is that instinct as a filmmaker that made you prioritize this over that? I think it makes it more of a practice, like a riyaz, and you let that process.
I don't think filmmaking is for me anything different from like doing painting or like writing every day or writing, poetry maybe or a song. I think that I try to look at it as that itself. And somehow you would try to make a film and it's like a sculpture only. Sometimes you chip away somewhere and some form comes and you're like, oh, this is a nice little thing. I just discovered this. And then after a while it starts looking ugly and you don't want it anymore. And then you chip some more and then it's gone. and then the shape looks totally different and you're like, oh, this is also something. So I see it like that, mm-hmm. that, you know, it forms as you go along with it, and how you went ahead first, I had a script and everything.
Mm-hmm.
But
that was not a documentary.
It was a documentary, but see, like, I'll tell you a little bit about the process itself,
yeah,
because
limitations.
Yeah, like, it's an FTI film. We made it in film school. So we had 6 days to shoot. We had limited footage, even though it's digital, because the institute is, like, living in some other zone. So they were like, you have this much only you can shoot, this many hours you can shoot in the day, and you can only do this. So now if you have these restrictions, you have to start, like, thinking how you can work around it. So me, like, I started approaching it through sound a lot, because there's no restriction on sound. And sound is so fantastic, no? Like, you hear a sound and then it is, it's a totally different imagination. It's like a third thing that it creates for you. That is, only, what am I seeing? I'm seeing some four walls of a little village hut. But there are so many sounds. There's this little love story between this husband and wife being playful. And, you know, it's like a whole other world. And you might want to associate it in a way that, oh, it might, you know, you might associate it with something personal. Or, I don't know, it's like, maybe like going for a walk up a hill. And sometimes you see a certain thing, or you see a little ant, or you see a little bark, or you see a whole tree. And that makes the journey of your hike up. And if you just drove to the spot to see the sunset, but you walked up, they're two different experiences. And I don't know, for me, like, cinema is that. It's a little bit of this, and you see a little bit of that. And together, the sum of the parts make a whole, which might be greater than the parts itself on their own.
So this, you're calling this a documentary because the exercise given to you was to make a documentary?
No, all the material has come from what I had. Like, I think documentary for me is also like scavenging.
Hmm.
Like, I'm in some pile of stuff. I have all this audio. Some of it I made them repeat because they were rambling like lots, the ladies. One of them, though, she was considered to be a mad woman in the village. But I thought what she was saying was much more pertinent than most of the Singh people were saying. So, yeah, so it's all, like, I've not actually made up anything. It's all coming from the space. Everything was said to somebody in the crew. In fact, my sound recordist would sometimes just go for walks and record things. Like the last conversation where she says that, don't go down there, somebody will kidnap you. That we didn't even know. He'd gone to record wind. And we kind of got it in that. And he doesn't even speak Marathi. So he's like, I don't know what this is, somebody speaking. And Shimpi spoke it, and I was like, oh wow, this is, like, kind of strange. So yeah, I think that's what's nice about documentary, you know, you stumble upon a few things. And there's a lot of material. Like, I could have made four films from this material. But I chose to make this one.
And what he was talking about in Harith, I'll just expound on
it.
So Harith gave this interview sometime back where he said that we are losing poetry in our cinema. We are tending to make too much sense of things. And a long time back, I had read someone try to explain in a very, very simple, succinct way to a child the difference between poetry and prose, prose being storytelling. He said, if you go into the garden and you lift a rock, what you see there, and when you write that down, it's poetry. But if you take a twig and poke and prod to see what happens, that's prose. So somewhere, though, you know, you're looking at the same material, but what you do with it, what your response to it is, it can take you into a more poetic or more prosaic space. And I think Kinaritu was lamenting that we are not, we're sacrificing poetry at the altar of trying to make too much sense of things.
Mm, yeah.
So that's why it's very hard for someone like me to categorize this as a documentary in my head, but when you talk about your practice or your process, then it's sort of, what else can it be?
Mm. Yeah.
It's a very ambiguous space.
We kind of designed the film through sound, like we did a whole sound design without any images first.
Mm. Wow.
And then Shimpi and I sat down and kind of said that, okay, let's do this. Because the sound was like, if you go to that space, you're really overwhelmed by the sound. You're overwhelmed by the sounds of the forest. You're overwhelmed by the insects, the birds. It's like, even the silence is not the same way that we experience it. And I don't know, for me, that was the most enticing thing about the space. And
No, I don't know how many of you all have seen Payal's earlier films, short films, but there is an approach, if it's a signature, if I may call it that, where you have these voices whispering, and they're whispering something and telling you a story, and juxtaposed with the image, which is not really elaborating what is being whispered, it's creating a different, slightly ambiguous context.
Hmm.
But your earlier film, say for example, Watermelon, Fish and Half a Ghost, is not really a documentary.
No, that's fiction. But over here,
I'm seeing the same signature, although you're saying it's documentary, you just worked with what you captured.
Yeah.
So are you going in there with a certain preconceived idea of how you want to capture it?
Yeah. I think what happens is that when you're making films, you end up finding what you seek only. You end up finding the same things, the same preoccupations, the same material. Whether you want it or not, perhaps that's exactly what you were looking for in the first place. And the whispering, a lot of these women didn't want to talk loudly. Like, especially the one who was telling me the story.
That just fit your style.
I was like, wow. But yeah, good only. But yeah, so the whole time she was, but like I said, that part, because she rambled a lot, and sometimes she was loud, sometimes she was soft. So I did interfere and say that you said it like this to me, why don't you say it? So that cheating I did a little bit. That's okay, I think, you know.
A short doc is so hybrid, there is no cheating really. I think the short film
is such a nice form,
right?
Yeah, you can do anything.
Exactly.
It's such a nice,
fluid
little form. And we really get into this plot thing. I mean, you know, on this short little thing, it's a small little jhalak, yaar. It's a chotu little thing. Just enjoy it for that little moment, like eating a berry or a fruit. It's so small, it's nice, you had a good time. Okay. You know, why get so much, like, into this?
I think that ends the Q&A. Yeah. One last question for the cinematographer, unless you have anything.
No, please.
I can, again, seeing her earlier work, I can sort of sense the impulse for the sound choices. The images, what is the impulse for those images? What made you capture those images? How was that sort of dovetailing into what this film was trying to be? Although it changed later.
Also, this is our second work together, and we have been practicing a lot.
So did Afternoon Clouds.
Yeah.
Yes. So, we kind of know each other a bit. That was a starting point. But also, we lived in that village for a long while. I mean, kind of lived in a sense. For a week we went there, then there was a Holi celebration, we went there and celebrated Holi with them. So it was a lot of time we were there, and a lot of our experiences, also because of that 6 days only we can shoot, and also there was a sense that we are going with some sense in our head that we want this, because at the end of the day we were also trying to create a film in 6 days, so there was something. So all these experiences were there. Now the idea was how to get them together. Now as she said that, there were a lot of sound design which we did. It's not this sound design, which we the final one, but there was a sound design which I used to hear a lot. We used to talk about it a lot. So all those experiences, like, you know, this small idea of having a berry, this actually happened to us there in that hot summer, you know, weather. So all these experiences and living in that village is just more experiential for me to create those images. So. Like there were at days and hours when she was there with the ladies talking, sound designer is, recordist is somewhere else, and I used to go somewhere else completely.
Oh, three poets operating. Like.
And so it was, and because we knew that village so well, and people were very comfortable with us, that yes, if I had put the camera in front of anybody talking to the camera, it would have been really difficult. But then if I'm there alone and shooting in the village, it's actually. I was able to capture the experience of it, like the winds or just the animals, just how the life is going about.
But after a while, was that the agenda? Or was
it became a it became a very fluid process for me. Yes,
I want to understand what is being communicated through that process between you.
No, that's what I'm saying. The last film, I think there we communicated a lot. That was a fiction film, and we kind of were trying to understand each other more, and you know.
Yeah, I basically like to do a lot of static shots and not move the camera and have
that. That was there from the last film, and we were talking about trying to make something on those lines. So there was a conscious decision of static camera, static images. Also, I knew that we are trying to create a cinema where the shots will go on for a bit of time. You're not going to cut. The intention is not to just show you the house and move on. Mm. Or so I was also looking for elements, things where I could sit there and feel. And because I had spent so much time in that village, I knew there were places where I could just sit there and experience it. And hence, I could, you know, even switch on the camera there and be there with the thing. And later, then how it flows in the edit is the part.
Mm. Like sometimes, like you have a, if you cut something, if you're cutting into something or you're cutting a shot, you're drawing attention to something small in the frame. But I wanted to do that through sound. So the canvas was like a large, sometimes you're looking at a painting, sometimes you look at a painting of a landscape, suddenly like the highlight, you'll see a little highlight and that will catch your eye there. But then suddenly you'll be like, that highlight will lead you to something else. So I wanted to have that kind of experience with a moving image. But also, but I have sound, unlike a painter, like I have sound. So I can do that through sound also, to shift the attention.
But the better metaphor here is video art. It's almost like video art.
A lot of things happen with patience, like that woman combing her hair and then the dog entering.
Yeah.
It was all very, we were just there and it happened. And because it happened because we had some patients there living there without our mobile phones. Had we been with mobile phones and signals,
it
probably
would
have been a little
film,
more impatient.
Yeah. But different
footage
film would have emerged, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, yes, that's true. So we were very patient. And we, it was more experience, that's what I'm saying. You know, we lived there for weeks and we also became one of part of the, you know, mise en scene and just be there. So it happened more like that.
But it's interesting, the process you're talking about is what the end result is. The film is not a film as much as it's an experience that I'm committing to.
Yes, I mean,
can choose
correct.
To not commit.
Yes,
to, yeah.
And that's what the film we intended to make was not this film. Because that was, we were going with something in our head and between, after 3 days, we knew that this is not happening. What we had a script in head with some characters, we had identified some people, interesting people, or some, it's not happening. In those first three days, we knew it's not going to happen like that. So let's take what the place is giving to us, let's, whatever we have experienced, that is in our conscious, and then we try to see it happening in front of us. So the process became, I think, the film, for me.
I actually didn't get much of it. So what was that
Brahma
Kumari?
Great
first
question.
I don't get it, sorry.
It's
the
Brahma Kumari. It's
not Brahma
Kumari.
What was that scene where the flower thing comes?
Painting.
Yeah, that was just a drawing I did. It was a drawing I wanted to do. Like, I didn't use voiceover in this film. So for me, the drawings were like my voiceover.
Did it mean something? Like,
I don't know, did it mean something to you?
No, it didn't, that's why.
Okay, for me it didn't mean anything, but I just felt a certain sadness of these women talking about love and this kind of story of the male bee dying after he makes love. And to me, juxtaposed together, there was such a lot of sadness in this. And with my silly little folky drawings, I thought about the man as a bee flying away and a flower being left behind. Yeah, he flies and now he's gone. So that was it. But I mean, it's okay if you don't get it also. Just for fun, you know. Sometimes you do something and it's like, okay, you like it. Why not? See, actually, I intended to do the film in black and white. And I had gone there thinking I'm going to make this like ethnographic film. And then I started realizing that, you know, if you see, like when we were growing up, we used to watch all these films about like these tribal villages and there'll be this bad voiceover and it'll be in 16mm and, you know, they'll be like, yahan pe tribal log ye karte hain aur, you know, aise khate hain aur aise peete hain. So I was trying to reference that in a kind of way that I'm not doing that, you know, to make this ethnographical film. It's like, because it's a tribal village, it's a very proper tribal village where, in fact, the guy who's looking for the bees, he is like the kind of the head of the village, and he was taking me for a ride. Like, he was like, "Hamara tradition to ye hai, ye shoot karo. You know, shoot this because it is us and you have to shoot this." And I was like, I was going also, like one falling into that hole. Like, theek hai. So, you know, like during the recce time, we would shoot with our camera. Whatever he was telling me to shoot, I was shooting it. So then I realized that, what am I doing? Like, I don't want to make this ethnographical film about this tribal village kind of thing. So I sort of referenced that idea of an ethnographical film but did something else with it. And that's why I wanted to be black and white. But I also liked the evenings and they were so beautiful and there was such a lovely blue. And it also sort of, for me, added to this sense of going into a dream and coming out of it. Because the black and white kind of starts with this wind that comes, and after the color, then you have this black and white, and then, you know, she says that, have you woken up or are you still dreaming? And the black and white for me has an ambiguity of time. Like, you don't really know what time of day it is when you see the black and white. You don't see the harsh sun. It was shot in the middle of summer. It's really hot. And the black and white makes this, I mean, for me at least, it had an ambiguity in the time sense. But like I sometimes, like I said about the drawings, sometimes I just like certain things. So I liked the evening, and I thought it had a really beautiful feel where you're coming out of this, like, a lot of catharsis, and then suddenly you're in this feeling of the evening. And that's what I hoped it did.
So I just heard him saying, say, in the first 3 days, you know that whatever in your head is there is not going to happen.
Mm.
So my question is, like I said, did you have apprehension that if something is not going to come out in 6 days, what you are going to submit? Okay. If that apprehension is there, so is that apprehension is pushing you towards getting something out of it? Because whatever you plan is not happening.
Actually, what happened, like, this sound recording I was doing much before. 1 year before, only I was going to record just the audio recorder, just recording sound. So already in my head I was thinking sound wise something, something. But I was not able to commit to it also, because thoda dar bhi lagta hai na. Matlab itna sab planning kiya, itna sab kiya, phir finally wohi baat pe chale jaoge to phir matlab, you know, there was a little bit of fear, like. But then I said, theek hai, let's, you know, do this thing only, what I've been recording. And the stories I've been getting, it is, I'm feeling it more, I'm connecting it to it more.
And another very frightening thing happens with, just to add to your question, it's a very good thing to discuss. Around the time when I started working in film, I assisted on Black Friday, and there was this atmosphere of, you know, of the things that make, go into making a genius. Like, 3 days mein script likhta hu. I'm like, theek hai. तो मैं समझ नहीं पाया कि 3 दिन में कोई स्क्रिप्ट कैसे लिखता है. मैंने सो वो जिंदगी में एक बार 3 दिन में लिखी थी स्क्रिप्ट, उसके बाद नहीं लिख पाए. तो समटाइम्स दीज सिचुएशंस आर सच दैट फियर एंड एंग्जाइटी लेड यू डाउन अ पाथ दैट लेड टू समथिंग मैजिकल. इट्स नॉट नेसेसरी दैट यू कैन रिपीट दैट, एंड देयरफॉर इट्स एन एक्सप्लोरेशन मोर देन अ प्रोसेस.
बट यू नो, लाइक आई मीन, लाइक यू हैव डन अ बंच ऑफ फीचर्स एंड शॉट्स, सो आर दोस एप्रिहेंशंस you know, at the same, like, levels when you're doing a short or a feature? Because, you know, like how we've been talking about a short form, you know, being more, like, liberating and, you know, where you can take more risks. I mean, what's been your sort of experience in that sense? I mean,
no, there's no comparison. That's why we're only showing shorts
yeah.
here, because they allow you to take
yeah.
those risks.
Exactly.
Even if you're operating with someone else's money, you're operating with an institute's material
yeah.
and money and resources, you can still take that risk. With a feature, there's too many people and money. Even if it's the smallest feature film possible, is like crore or 50 lakhs, that's shitload of money. And you can't go in there without some idea of where you're going to end up. If you have no idea where you're going to end up and you suddenly want to veer away, you'll end up in jail, because you'll have to pay those people back all the money that they're giving you. So it's not, almost not possible in the feature, unless it's a feature documentary that you are funding yourself and you're taking 4 to 10 years to make it, then that's a different process. I'm only talking about narrative fiction.
First of all, film was very beautiful, like he said, lullaby kind of, and like, and the way you did the transition thing from the scary loneliness to the love story, it was beautiful. That background scale came and the story came. The narrative was designed, how you designed the narrative, because it is quite difficult to, because it was, you said, documentary and all the voices were recorded, or narrator was also there, because of the language I couldn't make it.
No, it is all recorded only, like, from there, that's all. So it was like...
To design, it's like so difficult thing, because you designed in a proper narrative. For me, it has the impact of a film, not a documentary. Like the, it was.
No, documentary is not film. So sad. Don't say that.
Yeah, but not like
he means narrative
information.
Story.
But it's the aesthetically the poetic
okay.
justice the film does, the fiction does, the poetic justice was awesome. Like, first of all, I was like, शुरुआत में थोड़ा connect होने में, because आपको वैसे इन images से connect होने में दिक्कत आती है. Lekin when it ended and the love story thing, because the loneliness was so, why the dragging season, when the love story starts beautiful in that village with that background score, it was like very fascinating.
It's interesting you're using the words love story, background score,
yeah.
love story stuff. Very interesting.
Yeah.
That's one way of reading this, but I didn't respond to it like that at all.
Mm.
That ambiguity is probably how we're responding so differently.
Because there was
yeah.
so much of loneliness, I said again this, but then the love story in that village. Because I was trying to find out something from images only. That was not happening because sometimes their images were also monotonous, not beautiful ones.
Mm.
But then, and everything justified.
Which year was this made?
2017, we shot it, but we completed it in
2018. So imagine an FTI film, a diploma film, an institute film under this government, and there's a love story.
No, we couldn't censor this.
What?
Censored in a sense that we wanted to send it to somewhere, and you need a certificate for this.
They didn't give you a certificate.
No, no, we.
You had issues.
No, no, I tell you what. Let's clear the air.
I
will talk
about this. Yeah.
No, no, it's not a nobody cleared it or not clear it. The thing is, the whole idea of there are new rules about animals, right?
Yeah.
So we didn't know this, and we were obviously very preoccupied with the making of the film rather than figuring out that what's the process of getting a certificate. So now the new rule is that you have to apply online then about the animals, and we were not. It's not a fiction film where we were using animals. It was a village where we were shooting it. So the rules are so ambiguous about shooting a documentary in a village where there are animals that it took me around a month and still I couldn't figure out how to get this a certificate through the censor
board.
Because how to go about it. And in that, I read the rules. It says that prior to shooting a documentary, you have to inform that you are going to this village and figure that out. So
did you get a
sensor?
I didn't even bother.
You won't bother.
Yeah, that's all. So after
because there was no chance I would
yeah, so after a month of reading all documents and trying to figure out, I said, I mean, that's it. That's enough of my effort into figuring out this.
So if I may make this a little more murky, after May, the Animal Welfare Board has shifted from Delhi to Haryana.
Haryana, yes.
And I've made a feature film called Ghostly, and 40% of the film has cats, dogs, rats, cockroaches and crows. And we've been stuck at the Animal Welfare Board for the last 5.5 months, which is why the film's not releasing. The new rules after May are you cannot have them in frame. No discussion. You apply with the script, take permission from
yes,
us, tell
yes.
us exact durations of the shot.
Correct.
I said, I can't decide the cat will leave my frame after 13 seconds.
Yes.
I can't decide that.
Correct. So similar.
So my film's
yeah,
stuck.
Yeah.
I haven't even reached the sensibility.
So
oh my God, that's terrible.
So I left like kind of like that. I can't do it. Leave it.
I have a question. So for me, the film was about love, as we said. They were different. So while you were having that conversation with those ladies and some stories come up about her husband or something, so did it became a driving force to you to look for those love stories and make that as a flow?
All my films are about love only. So I think what happens is that, like I said, you seek, you look, you find what you're seeking only. तो फिर मैं घुमा फिरा के वही सवाल पूछती हूँ वही पॉइंट पे आ जाता है तो दो घंटे के बाद सब चीज़ के बारे में बात करें फाइनली तो आई थिंक लाइक वी आर ऑल ऑब्सेस्ड विद द सेम काइंड ऑफ थिंग अगेन एंड अगेन यू जस्ट वांट वेदर यू नो इट लाइक यू रिकॉग्नाइज इट और नॉट दैट्स व्हाट यू सीक सो या
आई हैड अ क्वेश्चन व्हिच आई गेस ऑल थ्री ऑफ यू कुड आंसर आई हैड अ क्वेश्चन व्हिच आई गेस ऑल थ्री you could answer is why do you think documentary filmmakers are not experimenting with the format? Like, I mean, this is great that we're getting to see such creative documentaries, right? Why do you think we are sort of not experimenting the documentary format?
We are, no? We are. In the last few years, 3 to 5 years, we are experimenting like crazy. I'll give you an example. 2013, the film that won the top award in Mami was a film called Katiyabaz. It's a documentary and it ends with this guy walking away and a slow crane shot like a Hollywood film
but
ends.
It's one in a million.
No, almost all
13,
documentaries today.
6 years.
13
six
onwards,
years.
I've only seen experimentation in documentaries. I've not seen state documentaries.
In fact, documentaries is an exciting format because you can do so much.
It's just that not too many documentaries per se are getting made. But the ones that are getting made.
I really beg to differ.
Yeah,
there's a lot of documentaries.
I was like putting together this session with this intent, in fact, of. You know, somewhere that, you know, your film, in your film, they are playing with the form. I mean, there are like different formalistic approaches that the both of them have taken on. I think maybe even my film does that to some extent, where it's a hybrid.
Yeah.
So we are seeing that Kunal, I feel it's
not enough, but
you know, to be fair to you, I know where you're coming from. In the last session, someone asked me, we had shown four spectacular short films in the last AABOBO session. Someone asked me, how do you find them? I said, I had to go through 150 shit fucking films before I found four. So there is a lot of shit out there. But the ones that are good and are being recognized and are being watched and are being screened are really experimenting with form.
Yeah.
To the point where I don't know what to call a documentary anymore.
That's true. Yeah, it's very like.
But there's a lot of shit, of course. Even with short films, there's too much shit out there.
I saw recently this documentary that was made inside a video game. I was like, wow, it's amazing. Like, the film was like a sniper game where, you know, you have a team of four people who go do shooting. But instead, they are doing a heritage walk inside the video game. So they have their guns with them. Like, we Bombay mein heritage walk karte na, so they are doing New York ka heritage walk because the video game is sniper game in
Swatted,
New York.
Swatted, yeah.
Not Swatted, it's called Jane Walk.
Okay.
Swatted is another amazing film.
Yeah.
So it's inside a video game. They're like, okay, like, let's not shoot, but this beautiful building is the Empire State Building. It was built in this year. So it's...
So it's an Indian documentary?
No, it's
no.
A German.
No, that's what I'm saying. I'm just talking about Indian documentaries per se, that you see a lot of experimentation and creativity in international documentaries.
No, Indian, the ones that are being celebrated, like Placebo, a lot of them, the ones that are being celebrated are really breaking boundaries. But obviously there's a lot of shit out there other than the ones being celebrated.
I mean, in the West, you also see this, a resurgence of cinema verite, because if I have such strong auteurs in the long format, like a Wiseman and all, they've had such influences that those filmmakers are not often able to break free from just making observational long form films. So it's not really, I get what you're saying, that I mean, if it's about volume, if it's I don't know, like, you know, what kind of a threshold we have to reach in on the numbers really to to qualify. But I think, like, the short documentary form as such in India is not really that celebrated.
Not many places to show it also.
You're at the bottom of the food chain pretty much right now, and it's going to take time. We've spoken a lot about this earlier also.
I think MIF shows a lot of experimental short docus.
Yeah. But otherwise, we've just got like one documentary film festival, I mean, apart from MIF, which is... which is IDSF, International Documentary Short Film of Kerala, which actually focuses on short documentaries. Mami doesn't even have a section dedicated to short docs.
True.
I mean, like Royal Stag,
Well,
they have the last short films, which is only fiction again. So it's going to take time.
But broadly, the documentary, ever since cinema was invented, the idea of the documentary was appropriated by the establishment, because most documentaries are hagiographies. Someone funds it, you have to tell their story. Like Dhoni funding the documentary on fucking Dhoni. So that has, in the larger consciousness of people, they see documentaries through that filter. They don't understand what you can do with that medium. So, and the few people who do it, they're mostly working with their own resources. There's a beautiful documentary called Khoki Palu that won last year, I think, at Mami. And those two filmmakers, they spent 7 years trying to raise money, crowdfunding. So that's why you get to see very little of that, because the establishment will not back something like that. What is in it for them? Make me a hero, I'll give you money to make your documentary. So the word is misunderstood. And
there has to be an ecosystem where an audience, from funding to audience, everything that comes in between, sales agents, PR, everything has to support it. Can't happen in isolation ki jao achhi documentary bana ke aao,
And I'm glad you asked this question, because we're trying to do a little bit of that here.
Yeah.
I'm hoping that at least half the people here will view documentaries a little differently after this evening.
Mm-hmm.
But we did have good documentaries back when everyone was producing with SNS Sastri and Pramod Patil.
Yes,
you
we did.
All of those
we did.
And there was an ecosystem that...
But at the same time, if you revisit those documentaries today in the light of the documentaries being made in Europe around that time, none of them, very few are really experimental, because Films Division also had a stranglehold on them.
Yeah.
You had to you know, commit a script, you have to commit a shot breakdown, you have to commit a timeline before they even allowed you to go take your first shot.
But they still figured out some loopholes with those.
They did. But I'm saying, yeah, you're right, they don't even have that today.
Yeah, so what happened?
This government happened. It's fairly simple. No, only in the last 7-8 years. Still, I think 6 years back, this guy called Pratik Vats made a film on Manohar Aich called The Man with Enormous Wings, a film's division documentary. He found his loopholes, made the film he wanted to make. In the last 6 years, it's gotten impossible. And now it's not going to happen. No, it's not. See the freedom that gives you, see how that liberates you. I keep telling people, think about Iran in the early 90s. If those filmmakers didn't have that kind of an iron vice grip around their neck, they would not come up with the cinema they came up with. And it's got to get really bad for us to really do a revolution through our art. And we are all in the middle ground, you know. We are like, hey, should we go this far? No. Let's play it a little safe. We are just fucking around with our art. We are not really pushing ourselves. So it gets hard, we'll all push ourselves. It's a good thing. I think we should see it as a good thing.
Yeah.